Hi, I'm Dr. Chad Hanson with the John Muir Project, and I'm going to be talking with you today about the fire oak hypothesis and all of the forest mismanagement that is occurring in the eastern deciduous forests of the U.S. as a result of this hypothesis. I'm going to be focusing on three key questions. You know, the first one is, does clear-cutting ecologically mimic natural disturbance processes like fire, and especially high-intensity fire patches? The second one is current prescribed fire management in eastern deciduous forests ecologically appropriate? Does it mimic natural fire patterns? And the third one is fire natural in eastern deciduous forests? Is it a natural part, and especially mixed intensity fire that has a high intensity component? And so I'm not a big fan of burying the lead, so I'm just going to answer all three briefly and then explain why in my presentation. The answer to the first one is absolutely no. Clear cutting does not mimic natural fire, including high intensity patches. Answer to the second one is absolutely no. Current prescribed fire management in the eastern deciduous forest does not mimic natural fire regimes. It is being applied at an unnatural hyperfrequency that's causing a lot of damage. And the third one is yes. I believe that the answer is, based on a lot of evidence that I'll go into in a moment, that fire is a natural ecological part of eastern deciduous forests, but that current land management does not reflect natural fire regimes, and I'll explain why. All right, so I'm going to talk a little bit about, you know, something that I know folks here have heard a lot about and been dealing with, and I think a lot of people here see as a significant threat to the forest, which is the fire oak hypothesis and the way that's being operationalized and, I would say, weaponized in forests of the eastern United States. And basically, the basic narrative is that historical fires were extremely frequent, low-severity surface fires, historical forests were very open, oak hickory dominated, applying a lot of frequent low-intensity prescribed fire will facilitate oak and hickory regeneration and dominance. Question is, you know, what does the evidence have to say about that? All right, so first part, does logging mimic fire? So I'm going to talk a little bit about some work I did in Southeast Texas. This is in the Bastrop fire that burned in 2011 in the Lost Pine ecosystem. It's a loblolly pine and post oak forest. And I took this picture in 2015 at 4 years post fire. This is a high intensity fire patch. It was mixed intensity, but there were some significant high intensity fire patches. That's all natural regeneration of loblolly pine in a large high intensity fire patch. Same thing, and this was common. This was a typical thing, and it's interesting because, you know, loblolly pine is thought of as being a frequent low intensity surface fire tree, but if it didn't have a long evolutionary history with high intensity fire, you simply wouldn't get a response like that. That tells you you've got an evolutionary history. It was pretty dramatic. That I took at 9 years post-fire. Now, there was no planting, no post-fire logging. That's all natural regeneration, and also no prescribed burning after the fire. Okay, so this is all natural regeneration, no messing with it. And, you know, just for perspective, the loblolly pines you can see there that are growing in amidst the loblolly snags, those were already about 25 feet tall, many of them, at 9 years post-fire. Just extraordinary. And of course, you know, I witnessed a lot of the same things I see in forests in the West, where they burn at high intensity. Woodpeckers foraging for wood-boring beetle larvae in the snags. Eastern bluebird in the West, it's western bluebird, a mountain bluebird, but they're using the cavities that the woodpeckers created in the year before, or the year before that. Redheaded woodpecker, pileated woodpecker. You know, so a lot of cavity nesters, primary cavity nesters, secondary cavity nesters, a lot of shrub nesting birds, a lot of wood warblers. That's restoration, so-called. All right? So to the question, does logging mimic fire? Absolutely not. This area had been post-fire logged and planted. And that's what you got. Almost everything they planted died. They'd done so much soil damage with the post-fire logging. They'd removed all the nutrients when they removed the down logs and the snags. They destroyed the native shrub cover. Basically what you had is bare ground and mostly invasive weeds. So where are the snag? And the understory, the native understory vegetation, essentially gone. So this couldn't be any more opposite of a what I call a snag forest and what we technically call complex early seral forest. There's no such thing as early seral habitat that the Forest Service likes to throw out that term. It's either early seral because it's a clear cut or it's complex early seral forest. And the two could not be more different. This is more similar to a parking lot than a forest. More of the same, right? So this is what they're calling restoration and reforestation. And some of this was on private land, some of this was on state parkland that they did. I just wanted to read this quote. I thought it summed up things really nicely. This was a study from 2002 about fire in eastern U.S. forests and wildlife habitat. And they just talk about how media coverage, you know, talks about how fire destroys the forest and how wildfires destroy the forest, destroy wildlife habitat. And they're just basically questioning that assumption and questioning the assumption that forests, you know, don't regenerate after a fire. And, and really what they're speaking to is natural succession, not succession coming from clear cuts, but natural succession coming from a natural disturbance process. And this is key because, again, when you have a process that happens on these longer cycles where trees are killed, you have habitat, you have carbon storage, you have natural succession. So I'm going to talk a little bit about a study that was published last year. Really interesting, important study. It dealt with two wildfires that happened in 2016 in the Nantahala National Forest in North Carolina. In forests dominated by oak, hickory, red maple, and tulip poplar. And these were mixed intensity fires, low, moderate, and high. And the scientists who are not exactly fans of post-fire habitat, you know, these are mostly Forest Service folks, but they followed the evidence and they published it. And they found that, first of all, in the high intensity areas, the shrub cover was the highest, no surprise there, because a lot of these plants are stimulated by hotter fire. And of course, in the high intensity, the snag density was the highest. Okay, so no surprise there, but important, because again, clear cut, you don't have that. As far as bird abundance, this is just total bird abundance. They found that certainly at least by year 3, 4, and 5, that the bird abundance was the highest in moderate and high severity areas, which is a really interesting finding. Now, we find a lot of this kind of stuff in the western forests. There's a lot of studies that have found similar things, but it's not something that's been looked at as closely in eastern forests. And this is bird diversity. Similar finding in the high severity by year 4 and 5, that's where some of your highest values are in terms of bird diversity. And I'll come back to that study in a little bit. All right, so do current prescribed fire policies in the eastern U.S. forests mimic natural fires? Do they restore forests? Okay, so back to Bastrop, Texas. In the southeast Texas, I took this picture at 9 years post-fire. And this was an area that had burned at high intensity. This was natural regeneration. This was not planted. That's all natural regeneration. Then Texas Forest Service came in and did a prescribed burn. And they used, it's a fairly mesic system there. Maybe not quite as mesic as where we are here, but you know, a lot more so than most areas in California. And they were having trouble getting the fires going, so they used accelerant. They lit it up and they killed vast areas of natural regeneration. This is an area that burned at high intensity, naturally regenerated in spectacular fashion with loblolly ponds and post oak. It was this beautiful area, and I walked through here at 5 years post-fire. I took this picture at 9 years post-fire after they did a prescribed fire. And they were applying prescribed fire on a 2-year interval. So their belief is that historically fires occurred every 2 years on average in loblolly post oak forests in Southeast Texas. Now, that's not true, and I'll tell you why I think that, but that's their belief. And so applying that, because they can't just get the low intensity surface fires that they want to go without applying a bunch of accelerant, they're just lighting up the landscape at 2-year intervals. And basically, they've deforested large portions of Bastrop State Park. Another example, and this one was just one prescribed fire. If they did another one, most of that would just be consumed, like the last slide. All right, you know, and just to this idea that that the forests were really low density historically, you know, obviously it changes at any point in time. And, there's no perfect consistency. Anyone that tries to apply some number, like a cookie cutter, across all the eastern forests, how everything burned every X number of years, it's just really not applying ecology. It changes by topography, it changes by elevation, it changes it by slope aspect. Vegetation communities change over short distances oftentimes, and so do fire regimes. This is just, you just look at the density of trees per hectare. You know, this was general land office surveys from 1806 and 1807 in southern Illinois. And also some pretty high tree densities in a lot of areas, obviously variable as well. You know, I wanted this one up just because it's important to keep in mind that when the Forest Service makes these arguments about trying to restore open forests and restore early seral habitat through clear cutting, really what they're doing is they're just exacerbating losses that have already occurred over the past two centuries due to logging and other forms of land clearing. And this is just one study that looked at this, Hanbury and Abrams 2018, and you can see from the late 1700s until I believe the modern era period was 1980s, and you can just see large areas of dense closed canopy forests that were lost, as well as open forest. But the really big losses in a lot of the closed canopy forests, and these are forests with more than 100 trees per acre, more than 250 per hectare. And this is another image that just kind of graphically shows the impact of this, you know, particularly focused on Illinois, and you can just see the impact in southern Illinois from 1820 to 1981, 1970s, 1981. You know, so the point is that they're not restoring forests by doing all this forest management. They're just exacerbating losses that have occurred over the last 200 years. We need more forests, more protected forests, not more trees removed and more clear cuts. And then, you know, there's the current management regime is frequent low intensity fire, and we're going to get a bunch of oak and hickory, and everything's going to be, you know, we're going to get all this regeneration. That's the narrative. But it's really not working that way for the most part. There's a lot of evidence out there, even from proponents of this kind of management, that indicates that it's not terribly effective. And frankly, you know, the argument could be made that it's quite ineffective. So why do they keep doing it? And why do they keep doubling down when the evidence, their own practices, their own studies indicate it's really not working out? It's not accomplishing what they say they want to accomplish. So is wildfire a part of eastern U.S. forests? And again, this one I approached with even more humility, you know, because there's a lot, I think, that's uncertain and unknown on this. But wildfire is a part of eastern forests, and it's a natural part. It didn't happen, in my view, nearly as frequently as the Forest Service claims. And I'll explain why I believe that. And in addition, and I'll get into this with some of the slides, that you'll see from some of the paleoecological evidence, you know, you can't take a snapshot in time and say, that's what the natural forest is. Forests are dynamic ecosystems. They go through natural succession due to natural processes. Climate changes over periods of time, even before we started messing with it. And forests track those changes. And so at various periods of time, different processes are more amplified or less amplified, and different species are more dominant or less dominant. You know, so this is just, you know, I have a few slides here of different paleoecological studies of charcoal analysis. And you can see, you know, this is basically over the last, numbers there is centimeters of depth. The time before present is on the far left there. And you can see, you know, it's going back, you know, 8,900 years, 11,000 years, et cetera. And so the depth is, you know, more further back into time. And you can see at various points in time, you know, there were bigger spikes of charcoal, you know, that pertain to more active fire periods. And then there are long periods where there wasn't any fire, right? So highly, highly variable. You couldn't say that, you know, it happened every X number of years like clockwork. It certainly didn't work that way. And same thing here, if you can look at the calibrated age range, you know, just look at some of uncalibrated, just a single figure there. Look at some of these are, you know, larger pulses of charcoal. You know, some of the authors of these studies acknowledge that, you know, smaller patchy fires that would happen periodically wouldn't have necessarily left much of a trace in the charcoal record. But so these would be, you know, maybe larger events, but you can see sometimes they're separated by long periods of time. Next slide. And and same thing here, you know, so multiple centuries oftentimes between larger, what would arguably be larger fire events. You know, these are different areas in eastern forests. Some of these are in the southern Appalachians, some of them are closer to where we are here, but you see a similar thing from the charcoal record, at least what's showing up in the charcoal record, which arguably are kind of larger fire years. You know, they are often separated by significant periods of time. We can move through this because it's basically showing the same thing. So, and then this goes to species composition. You know, this is from paleoecological studies, you know, from pollen records. And if you look at this, you know, over time, you know, from recent times going back 10,000 or almost 10,000 years, actually, sorry, that's not 10,000. You're talking about 2,000 years in this one. You know, you see a significant ebb and flow in oak and chestnut, these ones on the left. And at times, you know, more, at times a little bit less. And this one's interesting to me. I mean, if you look at this, you know, we've got a whole lot more oak in the last 3,000 years in this particular study site. This was in Kentucky. And also chestnut, but much less so, more than 3,000 years ago. So again, restoring historical forest conditions, we're restoring to what past exactly, right? What moment in the past? And who are we to say this moment in the past is the right moment in the past? We have to recognize these are dynamic systems. And same thing here, you know, this is from Tennessee, and you can see on the far left, significant variation over time in oak dominance. And more here, oak there is in the middle. It's hard to read there, but it says Quercus. And you can see in recent times, more recent times, last several thousand years, much more oak in this particular site in Virginia, and much less, more than about 7,000 years ago. So what I think it all means is that, you know, over time, oak dominance ebbed and flowed, and it wasn't always this kind of cookie cutter idea where it was just dominant. We got to restore it to that particular thing that it always was. That's just a mischaracterization of the ecological record. I do believe fire was a natural part of eastern deciduous forests, but I think it was much more infrequent. I also think it was at times mixed intensity, and it would track largely with climate fluctuations. There are periods of time when things are relatively drier. Where those dry periods are protracted, and lightning happens with different frequencies, and it may not happen that often, but sometimes those things are going to converge, drought years or multiple drought years, hot, dry, windy conditions, and lightning ignitions. And in those conditions, you're going to get bigger fires. So what do we make of the fire scar record from trees? Because that's what the Forest Service uses to justify their management. And they say, well, you know, if we look at these fire scar studies, and there's a bunch of them, that, historical fires were occurring in these forests, you know, once every 5 years, once every 9 years, once every 7 years, once every 3 years. And you can't reconcile on the surface these numbers with the paleoecological evidence from the charcoal record. So how do you understand these two things? I think the answer is a couple of things. One, if you look at the period of record and those Wright studies that cover Ohio and Tennessee and Virginia, look at the time periods. You know, so we're talking about every one of these studies is post-colonization. And there is a tremendous confounding factor there. Right? So these are not pre-colonial data. And that's a major, major problem, I think, for the Forest Service. The second thing, and this one just drives me nuts. The second one is, to me, in a way, more inexcusable. Because if you look at these studies, and I have, if you look at all the studies on fire scar data, what you'll find is researchers who used a particular study site. And then any given year in which a single tree within that study site had a fire scar, they count as a fire year. So if you have a study area that's 1,000 acres, make it a square, 1,000 acres, and a fire, and you've got 50 trees in it that you're using for your fire scar record, if one tree in this corner of the study area burns in a particular year, that's a fire year. And they assume that the entire study area burned. But we know that fires are often very small and patchy. They're spot fires. And so if you look at these studies, what they report is that typically the percentage of trees that actually have fire scars in a given fire year is between anywhere from 8 to 16% typically. Okay, so obviously they're overcounting dramatically. The other problem, and they don't take this into account, is that there's a really healthy body of science about lightning strikes causing fire scars, even if they don't cause a fire, right? So, you know, they're oftentimes using the biggest, tallest trees because they're oldest and they have a long fire record. Well, those big, tall trees are oftentimes the ones that get hit by lightning strikes. So a lightning strike can hit a tree, cause a scar, and not even cause a fire, not even at the base of the tree. So I think everyone should treat these sorts of data sets with a lot of suspicion. All right, so that's a quote from Arthur et al. 2012 about oaks, about certain traits. You talk about, you know, high light requirements, strong sprouting capacity, thick bark. And they were sort of talking about in the context of fire adaptations. I look at those adaptations and I don't think adaptations to frequent low-intensity fire. Those are adaptations that typically are associated with much less frequent mixed-intensity fire. Fire that will top-kill, for example, a tree and cause that basal sprouting. And let's see, another comment about from the same study about top-killing. So to me, you know, these are evolutionary adaptations that are typically associated with, and they're millions of years old, with fire that's of a sufficient intensity to actually kill the adult tree and cause basal sprouting, which is, again, more consistent with much less frequent fire that's more mixed intensity. And in addition, you know, you've got some species that that are really, you know, strongly associated with fire, that are mixed in the forest in various areas, like shortleaf pine. And in fact, you know, some serotonous species. And serotony is a trait that certain tree species around the world evolved generally between 90 and 120 million years ago, that is a specific adaptation to high-intensity fire in particular, not just fire, but high-intensity fire, and basically where the reproduction is inextricably linked to fire on the more intense end of the spectrum. This is a picture on the right of pitch pine from New Jersey after a high-intensity fire patch. That's all natural regeneration, of course. And you can see, you know, there's the density is highly variable, but this is just the general range map. And you see, you know, this is a species that has an evolutionary history that is inextricably linked with not just wildfire, but fire at the upper end of the spectrum. All right, so back to the Greenberg et al. 2023 study from the Nantahala National Forest. Interestingly, you know, they looked at several different individual bird species, and you can see, you know, the yellow is high intensity fire, the moderate is green, and you can see that for several of these bird species, they reach their higher abundance at least by years 4 or 5 in the higher intensity fire areas, either moderate or high or both, and you know, five of the six species range fairly widely across eastern U.S. forests. One of them is much more narrow, the chestnut-sided warbler. But this, again, indicates to me an evolutionary history that is more complex, more nuanced, more dynamic than the Forest Service indicates, and fire that is a fire regime that's not consistent with frequent low-intensity fire like they're trying to do with their prescribed fire burning, which I would say bears no relationship. What they're doing with prescribed fire bears no relationship to a natural fire regime. Far, far, far too frequent, oftentimes applied with the intention of generating homogeneous low-intensity effects. And the same study, they looked at different nesting guilds, tree nesters, cavity nesters, shrub nesters, ground nesters. Most of these nesting guilds, they actually, again, had the highest abundance in moderate and high-intensity fire areas, including cavity nesters, both primary and secondary. For primary cavity nesters, their sample size was much smaller. A lot of the woodpeckers are fairly rare. And so the variance was so high, they did not get statistical significance. But numerically, again, the result was, you had a higher abundance. So I guess my point is this, is that I think we need to think about and talk about wildfire from lightning strikes in a different way than the way we think about and talk about the Forest Service's artificial prescribed fire management. In the eastern deciduous forest, it's not gonna happen very often. And I don't think it ever did happen that often. In any given spot, okay, in any given year or a few years, yes, you're going to have some patches. But the larger fire years, I think they were fairly rare events. But at the same time, when they do occur, it's not an ecological disaster. There are species that benefit. So I think that basically the Forest Service is doing absolutely everything wrong. They're clear cutting, saying they're creating early seral habitat, when it bears no relationship to complex early seral forest created by high-intensity fire patches. And then they're lighting up the landscape with these hyper-frequent, unnatural frequency of prescribed fires that bear no relationship to what I think is a more recent analysis of the paleoecological record and the evidence. All right, so a couple other notes and then happy to open up to questions. But one thing I'm seeing these days lately is an effort by land managers, especially Forest Service, to export the narrative from the Western forest to the East. This narrative that the forests are overgrown, and if they're denser, they're going to have too much fuel, and they're going to burn much more intensely in a fire. And so, what we need to do to protect communities from fire, and especially in the wake of Gatlinburg in 2016, they say what we need to do is do a bunch of logging out in the forest and thin the forest out, and that'll curb the fires and it'll make it burn at low intensity and we can easily put it out. None of that's even remotely true. It's not true in the East. It's not true in the West. It's certainly not the way you protect communities from wildfire. The only way to protect communities is home hardening, defensible space pruning, the immediate vicinity of homes, evacuation assistance, community fire safe shelters, direct assistance to communities, not backcountry logging. That's not going to stop a weather and climate-driven fire. And in fact, the evidence indicates that removing a bunch of trees from the forest typically makes fires burn hotter and faster toward the towns. So I think they're doing everything wrong there too. But I just raise this because I'm getting more and more calls, about people saying, hey, Forest Service or a state agency is promoting these logging projects supposedly as fuel reduction and to protect the community from fire. And so we're seeing a lot of that same thing. If this comes up, we deal with it all the time in the West, so always feel free to reach out, and we've got all kinds of stuff we can give you to combat that narrative if they try to weaponize it. All right, so what is the path forward? Well, it's been said before, but I'll say it again, pro-forestation. We need a lot more forest protection, and soon. And not just we need to get the Forest Service out of the logging business and the other federal land agencies out of the logging business. And we need to allocate public funds for acquisition from willing sellers so we can expand the protected public lands system, especially in eastern forests where there's not nearly enough public forest lands. And so, obviously from a biodiversity standpoint, it's the right thing to do. And, Steve spoke to that earlier, and I completely agree. From a climate standpoint, a number of speakers earlier, spoke to this. It's what we have to do. It's essential, okay? We cannot overcome the climate crisis just by getting away from fossil fuels. I talk about this in my book, Smokescreen. I won't go into all the arguments on that again. But the science is very loud and clear that we have to also protect ecosystems so they can draw down the excess carbon. And the ones that do that the best are forests by far. And if people want a whole lot more information, they can get it in my book, Smokescreen. And thanks again for inviting me out, and happy to take questions.